This
That is about
conference will
the
now be
possibility
recorded.
of quantum computation. So as already I have mentioned, this topic, DNA isolation and purification, it comes in unit 13, that is recombinant DNA technology or rDNA technology. And it's the first portion, that is part A from unit 13, rDNA technology in the CSIR syllabus. This already I have mentioned. So today, I think rest all, I think Mavinia, Shalini, Shanmati, Prema Kumari, Kanimuri, Smita Kumari, all dear participants, they have already attended the first session. And those who have not attended the first session, please go through the YouTube channel or our other platforms, other online platforms, so that you can just go through the previous presentations as well. Okay, so anyway, we are just continuing with our topic, DNA isolation and purification. We will go for a quick recap and then we will go to the new topics. Fine. So the purpose of DNA isolation and purification, concentration, quantification, everything I have already mentioned actually, just to obtain the foreign DNA or the desired gene so that we can go for recombinant DNA experiments. Fine. We can transfer the desired gene from donor organism to recipient organism by a vector, and we can express the foreign gene in the recipient organism so that the recipient organism will become a recombinant organism and the product will be a recombinant product. Fine. It is quite widely applicable in various fields such as food, pharmaceutical, even our environmental cleaning. That means in order to prevent the pollutants, all those things. Fine. So lot of applications are there for recombinant DNA technology. So it's all start with the isolation of DNA. So what are all the various steps involved? Already I have mentioned in the first class. First of all, basically here we are going to talk mainly about bacterial DNA isolation and purification. So it consists of, in the first step, what we will do, we will culture the bacteria, which bacteria we are going to isolate the DNA from. For example, if it is E. coli, we will obtain a pure culture of E. coli. We will grow it in a suitable medium. Fine. Then the cells will be removed and broken to give the cell extract, because DNA is present inside the bacterial cell. So bacterial cell is having an outer cell wall, and inside the cell wall, there will be a plasma membrane. Inside that, you will have all the organelles. That is the protoplasm, cytoplasm plus nucleus. You will have all other various organelles. So the cells has to be harvested and the cells has to be broken in order to get the cell extract. So the cell extract contains DNA, RNA, proteins, other organelles, all those things will be there. Then from there, in the third step, you can see here, all the steps are already mentioned also. And even this is the first step actually. Fine, this is the first step where we are growing the bacteria. In the second step, what we will do, we will remove the cells and obtain the cell extract. In the third step, the DNA is purified from the cell extract. Fine. So there are various methods for that. Some of the methods we have seen in the last class. And then finally the DNA is concentrated. So these are the four steps involved in recombinant in the isolation and purification of DNA. Fine. So then, yes, in the next step, what we are doing, we are, so these are the four steps involved in DNA isolation. Fine. Now, in the first step, what we are going to do, we are going to break the cell, or we are going to break the cell membrane as well as the cell wall as well as the plasma membrane. So what are all the various methods involved in that? Either we can do it by physical methods such as mechanical forces, For example, we had discussed in the last class about various methods like ultrasonication and all those things. These are all the various physical methods, whereas generally in case of bacteria, we are using chemical methods are commonly used in the case of bacterial cells. So what are all the chemical? So in the case, so already I have mentioned bacterial cell, it is having a cell wall. Inside the cell wall, there will be a cell membrane or plasma membrane. Fine. So in order to isolate the DNA, we have to break the cell wall as well as the plasma membrane. Then only the contents will come out of the cell. Fine. So we will use different agents. One agent will attack the cell wall, whereas the other agent will disrupt the cell membrane or the plasma membrane. So these two we have to do. We have to select few agents by which cell wall will be attacked or broken and the cell membrane or the plasma membrane will be disrupted. So what all things we are using? It all depends upon the species of bacteria. So for gram positive, we will be using some chemical agents or enzymes, whereas for gram negative, we are using some others. But generally when we are speaking, most of the recombinant DNA experiments we perform using gram negative organisms, for example like E. coli and all. Fine. So usually we use enzyme, that is lysozyme, then a chemical, that is EDTA, ethylene diamine tetraacetate, or a combination of both. So either we can use lysozyme alone or EDTA alone or as a combination. Fine. Now what is lysozyme? Already we mentioned in the last class, present in egg white, it is an enzyme. It is also present in tears. It is also present in saliva. Then what is the exact function of lysozyme? If we add lysozyme to a bacterial cell, or if we treat bacterial culture with lysozyme, it will digest the polymeric compounds that give the cell wall its rigidity. So the function of cell wall in a bacterial cell is to provide overall rigidity to the cell. So in order to isolate the DNA, first we have to break the cell wall. For that we are using the enzyme lysozyme, which will digest the polymeric compounds. Polymeric compounds means cell wall will be made up of either polypeptides, fine, so polymeric compounds are nothing but it is a combination of monomeric compounds like polysaccharide. It is made up of monosaccharides, disaccharide, like that. Then polypeptides made up of monopeptide, dipeptide, like that. So polymeric compounds are nothing but the combination. Fine. So that is the function of lysozyme, followed by EDTA. What is EDTA? Ethylene diamine tetraacetate. What it will do? If we are treating it, it will remove the magnesium ions. Now, what is the function of magnesium ions? Magnesium ions are essential for preserving the overall cell structure. So lysozyme will digest the polymeric compounds, whereas EDTA or ethylene diamine tetraacetate will remove the magnesium ions, which is important in order to maintain the overall structure of the cell envelope. Also, in addition, it will inhibit the cellular enzymes that could degrade the DNA. So EDTA will remove the magnesium ions, as well as it will act upon cellular enzymes which promote apoptosis or DNA degradation or cell death. Fine. So these are the functions. Now, usually we use either lysozyme or EDTA or both in order to lyse the cell. But we can generally we are using a detergent such as SDS also. So either EDTA or lysozyme or a combination is enough in order to break the bacterial cell. But usually we also use a combination with a detergent such as SDS, sodium dodecyl sulfate. What is the purpose of SDS? It helps in the process of lysis by removing lipid molecules. So SDS is a detergent, hence it will act upon lipid molecules and remove it. As a result, this removal of lipid molecules by EDTA will accelerate the process of cell lysis, that is by disrupting the cell membrane. Fine. Now cell lysis is over. After lysis, the final step is removal of insoluble. So after cell lysis, what you will be having? You will be having DNA, you will get proteins, you will get RNA, you will get various cell organelles, you will have insoluble cell debris, everything will be in a, you are getting a mixture. Fine. So from the mixture, our next purpose is to isolate only the DNA out, elute the DNA out in a purified form, in a concentrated form, so that we can go for our recombinant DNA experiments. Fine. So after cell lysis, we will go for a centrifugation so that cell extract, that is the DNA, RNA, proteins, everything will be in the form of a supernatant, whereas all the insoluble cell debris and all other things, fine, with comparatively high molecular weight, you will get in the form of a pellet. This is the first step in DNA isolation. So it is already it is depicted by a picture. Cell lysis disrupt the cell wall, you will be getting a cell extract. Cell extract, you will go for centrifugation and you will get the DNA, RNA and proteins in the supernatant. Clear? So I am going in a fast pace because all those things we have discussed in the last class. Clear? So now next step is purification of DNA. So now what we have in our hand, we have a mixture which contains DNA, RNA and proteins. Fine. That is DNA with impurities we have now. So from that mixture or from that mixed cell extract, we have to remove the DNA out. For that, what we are going to do? So as already I have mentioned, in addition, you will have proteins and RNA. Now various methods are used to purify DNA from this mixture. Either we will treat it with organic reagents and enzymes. That is one method. Either we can treat the mixture with some organic reagents and enzymes which will degrade contaminants. So what are the contaminants here? You can see in the picture. DNA with contaminants. So DNA is what our target. Contaminant means it will be proteins and RNA. So if we are going for treatment with organic reagents and enzymes here, we are applying some organic reagents and enzymes, we will get the DNA in a pure form. How? That is, the proteins and RNA will be removed, or the proteins and RNA will be degraded or disintegrated so that pure DNA is obtained in the vial. Okay, that is one method. Now, another method is by using ion exchange chromatography. So in ion exchange chromatography, what we are going to do? We are going to separate the mixture. So this is a mixture which consists of DNA, RNA and proteins. From there, using ion exchange chromatography, we will separate the contaminants. That is, we will separate the RNA and proteins out, whereas you will get DNA in a purified form. So these two methods are widely used for the purification of DNA from the cell extract. Either we will apply, or either we will treat the cell extract using organic reagents and enzymes so that they will degrade the RNA and proteins and the contaminants, and you will get DNA in a purest form. Otherwise, we will treat the mixture, or we will subject the cell extract to ion exchange column chromatography so that we can elute out the components of the mixture on the basis of electrical affinity. All those things we will study in detail in the coming slides. Okay, so here what we will do, we will elute out first of all proteins and RNA so that DNA will be left in the mixture. Fine. So these are the two methods we are used for purification of DNA from the cell extract. Clear? Then so yeah, so now usually we use these two methods. Fine. Either we will treat it with phenol mixture, phenol and chloroform mixture. Okay, once again. Yeah, yes. How we are removing it with organic extraction and enzyme dye. So two methods are there already, I told you. In first method, we will be using organic reagents and enzymes. In second method, we will be using ion exchange chromatography. So in the first method, how we are going to separate RNA and proteins from the cell extract? For that, either we will use phenol or a mixture of phenol and chloroform. This is what we are using. That is, this is used for deproteinization. That means to remove the protein. So to remove the proteins, either we can use phenol or a 1:1 mixture of phenol and chloroform. Now, it will precipitate proteins but leave the nucleic acids, that is DNA and RNA, in the aqueous solution. So if we will treat the cell extract using phenol, what is going to happen? DNA will be proteins will be precipitated out like this. You can see here a yellow color. See, these are the proteins which are precipitated out, whereas DNA and RNA will remain in the mixture. Clear? So for that, what we are going to do, we mix, we take the cell extract and treat it with the solvent, fine, so that protein molecules are precipitated and left as a white coagulated mass in the interface between the aqueous and organic layer. So here you have the cell extract, that is the aqueous layer or the water layer, fine, and you are mixing it with phenol. As a result, proteins are precipitated and it will remain between the aqueous layer, that is the water layer, also the phenol layer. It will be in the middle. Now in the aqueous layer, now what is left after proteins are gone? DNA and RNA will only be left in the aqueous layer. Clear? So this is the method by which we are isolating or we are removing proteins from the cell extract. Fine. So, but in certain cases this will not work out properly. Why? Because the protein content will be very high in certain cases. In that case, this phenol treatment or phenol chloroform mixture treatment will not give us pure DNA RNA mixture. In that case, we cannot go for repeated. That is the, so first of all, we are going for a phenol chloroform mixture treatment. You will be getting DNA plus RNA and maybe some proteins will also left there. Again, we are going for another phenol chloroform mixture treatment. What is going to happen? The breakage of DNA molecules will take place because we are continuously, we are treating the cell extract mixture with phenol and chloroform in two or three times. If we are continuing one after the other, there is a possibility that DNA molecules will be broken down. In order to avoid that, what we can do, we can go for enzymes such as protease. Examples are pronase or proteinase. What are protease enzymes? Protease enzymes will break down polypeptides into smaller units. So before adding phenol or phenol chloroform mixture, the cell extract will be treated with a protease enzyme such as pronase or proteinase K, so that polypeptides will be broken down into smaller units. Fine. So after getting that, is polypeptides will be broken down into smaller units such as monopeptides, dipeptides, like that. After that, this mixture will be treated with phenol or phenol chloroform. As a result, all these peptides will be removed and you will get the pure DNA RNA in the aqueous layer. Clear? That is one method. Now, after phenol chloroform mixture treatment, still some messenger RNA will be removed. mRNA molecule, so we told you, we have already seen in the, last picture. We have already seen the last picture. See, here the aqueous layer consists of DNA and RNA. Fine. Whereas proteins are only precipitated. Clear. But still, here majority of the RNA will be there in the extract, even after the treatment. Okay. Some of the mRNA molecules will be removed. Some of the messenger RNA molecules will be removed after phenol chloroform treatment. Still, most of the RNA will remain with the DNA in the aqueous solution. So in order to remove the RNA, we have to use the enzyme ribonuclease. What will do? It will degrade the molecules into ribonucleotide subunits. Fine. So, which means if we are directly going for phenol or phenol chloroform mixture treatment in order to remove RNA and proteins, there will be some issues. For example, if a cell consists of more protein content, we cannot go for treatment with phenol chloroform mixture for more than one time, since it will lead to the breakage of DNA molecules. As a result, before going for phenol or phenol chloroform mixture treatment, we have to treat the cell extract with both proteinase, that is protease enzyme, and also with ribonuclease, so that protease enzyme, what it will do, it will degrade the polypeptides into monopeptides or dipeptides, so that after this phenol chloroform treatment will follow and all these proteins will be removed. Similarly, the cell extract can also be treated with ribonuclease enzyme, so that ribonucleotide subunits will be degraded and it will also be removed by this phenol or phenol chloroform mixture treatment. Clear? So I think till here we have taken in the last class. Fine. So this was just a recap of the last class. Fine. If you want to get a detailed view of what we have discussed till now, you have to go to the YouTube channel or our other online platforms and please go through the previous presentation. So all these steps are described in detail there. Clear? So now we are continuing with the process. So as already we have mentioned, now what we are performing the separation or purification of DNA from the cell extract. That is, cell extract will contain, cell extract in addition to DNA, it contains RNA and proteins. So our purpose is to remove RNA and proteins and extract DNA in the purest form. One method is by phenol chloroform treatment, which we have seen in the last slide. Fine. So the second method is by ion exchange column chromatography. Fine. So all of you know what is chromatography. Before going to ion exchange column chromatography, I think I have asked this question last class. What is chromatography? So you have given me an answer. Now, so here, how we are performing? Based on the differences in electrical charge to separate mixtures into their individual components. So ion exchange column chromatography is all about separation of individual components of a mixture by means of differences in electrical charge. For example, our cell extract consists of DNA, RNA, and proteins, which is having their own electrical charges. So based on the electrical charges, we will be separating these three components. Based on the electrical charge as well as the electrical affinity. Electrical affinity means binding onto charged surfaces. That is what electrical affinity. Fine. Ion exchange chromatography separates molecules according to how tightly they bind. That's what I call electrical affinity. How tightly they bind to electrically charged particles present in a chromatographic matrix or resin. So, if you have studied chromatography, you know. In chromatography, what we are performing? We are performing the separation of components of a mixture. There will be a stationary phase and a mobile phase. Stationary phase is nothing but we call resin or matrix. See, you can see here, matrix or resin. That is nothing but the stationary phase. Now, this matrix or resin, the stationary phase will be mainly composed of some organic polymers such as microbeads. Have you heard this term, microbead? Everyone, have you heard the term microbead? Microbead. Yes, anybody, have you heard the term microbead? I hope everyone has slept actually. No reply. Anyone? No? Okay, Mavinia, thank you. See, microbead is nothing but, you don't have to get confused, what is that? Microbeads are nothing but small sized particles of maybe a particular mm of size or something. Okay, just assume like we take a column. You know what do you mean by a column, right? A column means nothing but a, what I can tell you, I will show you that better. I will show you. Wait. Okay, you can see here. See, this is nothing but a column. Clear? This is nothing but a column. A column is nothing but you will be having a support. Inside this column, you will be filling it with something. Like, for example, if you have a column made up of plastic and you are filling it with soil, it is nothing but it is like a column. Now I think it is clear for you. What is a column? A column is nothing but you will be having an external support made up of maybe plastic or glass or whatever it is. Inside that you will be filling it with a component. So microbead is nothing but They are small sized particles made up of organic polymers and they are charged in nature. Fine. These microbeads usually we are using as the stationary phase in column chromatography. Fine. So in column chromatography, so in any chromatography, so have you performed a paper chromatography? How many of you have done chromatographic experiments in your college? Can you just tell me yes or no in the comment box? Fine. Yes. So you know, Shalini knows what is chromatography. They have done. Have you done paper chromatography? Anybody? Paper chromatography or thin layer chromatography? I think all those experiments we used to do in the college. Yes, Shalini has done. Maunia has done. Then, any other person? I think we have around 10 participants. So 10 participants. Darshana, Kanimuri, Priyama Kumari, Shanmadi, Smita Kumari. Then one new member has arrived. UOMD Aslam. No, you have not done. Fine. Okay. Leave it. See, in chromatography. Yes, Kanimuri. Thank you. So in chromatography, what we are having, you will be having a support. You will be having a stationary phase. So for example, in your paper chromatography, paper is the stationary phase. And you will be having a mobile phase such as a solvent. It will move through the paper. In thin layer chromatography, you will have a glass plate on which you will make a matrix. That is your stationary phase. Again, the mobile phase will be the solvent actually. Similarly, here in ion exchange column chromatography, you will have a column made up of microbeads. What are microbeads? They are small sized particles, microbeads, charged particles made up of some organic polymer. That's what. Fine. That will be your stationary phase in ion exchange column chromatography, and your mobile phase will be salt solutions. Now, why we are using salt solution and why we are using microbeads, we will see in the next paragraph. Fine. Now, both DNA and RNA are negatively charged as well as some proteins. So, in ion exchange column chromatography, we are going to separate components based on the electrical charge as well as the electrical affinity. So here, what is the charge of our components? The charge of our components, that is DNA, RNA, as well as some proteins, are negative. Hence, we are using a positively charged resin, that is positively charged matrix or resin we are using here. This positively charged matrix or resin will be nothing but microbeads made up of some organic polymers, which is positively charged in nature. Now, do anybody have any doubt why we are using positively charged resin? If anybody have any doubt, tell me now. Why we are using positively charged resin for separation? No? Why? Then now tell me the reason. Why we are using positively charged resin here as a stationary phase in order to isolate or in order to separate DNA, RNA and proteins? Why we are using a positively charged resin? Why we are not using a negatively charged resin? Because DNA is negatively charged. Okay, that I understood. DNA is negatively charged. RNA is negatively charged. Protein is also negatively charged. I do understood. But why we are using a positively charged resin? That is my question. Why we are not using a negatively charged resin? Why? Reason. Anybody can type in the comment box. Anybody can type in the comment box. What is the reason? So affinity will be there between positive and negative charge. Very good. That means we have studied from the school classes, like charges repel, unlike charges attract. So in order to attach negatively charged DNA, RNA and proteins, we have to use the opposite charge, that is positively charged resin for ion exchange column chromatography. So we are using positively charged resin now. The electrical attachment is disrupted by salt. So once we add the cell extract on positively charged resin, what happens? The negatively charged components will attach to the column. So after that, if we have to remove this, we have to use some salt solution. Then what is the principle? Removal of more tightly bound molecules require higher concentration of salt, which means we remove the attached DNA, RNA and proteins from the stationary phase or the resin by means of different concentrations of salt solution. That is, by gradually increasing the salt concentration, different types of molecules can be detached from the resin one after the another. Clear? What we are going to do? We have selected a column made up of some material, plastic or whatever it is. Now, inside the column, we pack the column with a resin or matrix, which is nothing but positively charged microbeads made up of organic polymers. Fine. Why we are selecting positively charged resin? Because the DNA, RNA and proteins are negatively charged in nature. So, unlike charges will only attract. As a result, if we select a positively charged resin, the negatively charged components will attach to that. Now, after attachment, what we will do? We have to elute it out, or we have to remove it. In order to remove it or elute out the components from the positively charged resin, we are using different concentrations of salt solution. That is, by gradually increasing the salt concentration, different types of molecules can be detached from the resin one after the another. Because ion exchange column chromatography basically works on two principles. First of all, electrical charge. Second one is electrical affinity, which means how tight the molecules are bound on the column. Clear? Now, how we are doing the performance, how we are doing the protocol. The simplest way to carry out ion exchange column chromatography is to place the resin in a glass or plastic column. So, column is made up of glass or plastic, already I have told you. Now, the resin or the matrix is made up of microbeads derived from organic polymers. Fine. First of all, add the cell extract at the top of the column. So, what is happening? The cell extract is nothing but the, it's a aqueous layer. Fine. It is nothing but it is having water. So, the cell extract will move from the column from the top to the bottom. And the cell extract, since it contains a very little salt, all the negatively charged molecules will bind to the resin. That is the thing. First of all, we set up the column and we add the cell extract. The cell extract contains DNA, RNA and proteins. Also, the cell extract contains a very little amount of salt, so that all the negatively charged DNA, RNA and proteins will attach with the positively charged column or the positively charged resin or matrix. Clear? And are retained in the column. It will remain in the column. We will give some incubation time. After that, if a salt solution of gradually increasing concentration is passed, salt solution we have to add, but we have to provide increasing concentration, that different types of molecules will be eluted. Elution means nothing but separation and collection of components of a mixture from the chromatographic column. That's what elution means. Elution means to separate out. Clear? That means after the attachment of negatively charged biomolecules on positively charged column, we add salt solutions with a gradually increasing concentration, so that based upon the electrical affinity, that is the amount of bounding, one by one the components will be separated out in the sequence. First of all, the first salt concentration, you will get the proteins. Then you will increase the salt concentration, you will get the RNA, and finally you will get the DNA. So different salt concentration. So usually two salt solutions are used. One concentration is sufficient to separate, or one concentration is sufficient to elute the protein and RNA, so that after the removal of protein and RNA from the column, you will have only DNA in the column. Now, followed by a second of higher concentration, which eludes the DNA free from the proteins and RNA contaminants. Fine. So in column chromatography, how we proceed? First of all, we select a column made up of plastic or glass. Then we fill or we pack the column by using a resin or matrix, which is made up of microbeads. Microbeads are small particles which are derived from some organic polymers with a specific size, maybe some few mm size. Also, it is positively charged in nature, since the DNA, RNA and proteins are mainly negatively charged. Then after setting up the column, we will add the cell extract, aqueous cell extract solution on the top of the column. It will move downwards. During this movement, all the negatively charged particles will get attached with the positively charged column, that is RNA, DNA and proteins. Then after that, first of all, we will pass a salt solution from the top of the column to the bottom with a particular concentration. This salt solution will elute out or separate out all the RNA and proteins from the column, so that now the column has only DNA attached to the microbeads. After this, a salt solution with a higher concentration will be passed through the column, so that the separated DNA will also be eluted out as a pure solution, which is now free from all DNA and RNA components. Now, this column chromatography can be either done by gravity flow. Gravity flow means the movement of solution through the column, or the movement of solvent through the column takes place only on the basis of gravity. Gravity means the earth's attraction from the top to the bottom. If we throw a stone upwards, it will come down due to gravity. Similarly, the solvent or the solution will move through the chromatographic column by means of gravity. That is one method, by gravity flow. Another method is by spin column method. Spin column method, what is spin column method? In school, spin column method, what we do? We will place column on a low speed centrifuge. We set up the column on a low speed centrifuge, so that centrifugal force will also help in movement of solvent from the top of the column to the bottom. In gravity flow method, only due to the gravitational force, whereas in spin column method, we set up the column on the top of a low speed centrifuge, so that centrifugal force will also play a role in the movement of components from the top of the column to the bottom. Clear? Before winding up this topic, we will just go to the next slide. So here you have a pictorial representation of what we have studied about ion exchange chromatography. So first of all, see, these are all, this blue color, this is nothing but the ion exchange particle, which are the microbead. Microbead will look like this, small beads, fine. All those are positively charged. When we treat it with the biomolecules, you will get something like this. See, DNA or the RNA or the proteins will be attached with the microbead like this. So once the attachment has taken place, though, here DNA is there, proteins will also be get attached like this, RNA will also be get attached like this. Attachment of DNA to ion exchange particle. So here you can read it as attachment of either DNA or RNA or protein to ion exchange particle. That is the first step. The second step, you have the cell extract. Now this is all with attached DNA, RNA and protein molecules. You will add salt solution in a particular concentration, so that the attached RNA and protein, see here, protein and RNA will be eluted out, and which is discarded. Clear? So now you have only DNA. You are adding a higher salt concentration, so that DNA will also be eluted out. So here you can see only DNA is eluted out from the column. Clear? Very simple. Very simple ion exchange chromatography is very simple, basically. Fine? Only you have to know why we are doing ion exchange chromatography, what is the principle, what is the stationary phase, what is the mobile phase, what is taking place while proceeding with ion exchange chromatography. That's it. Fine. Any doubts about ion exchange chromatography? Anybody? Please type in the comment box if you have any doubts regarding ion exchange chromatography. Anybody? Yes, Mavaniya, Shanmadi, Priyama Kumari, Kanimudi, Darshana Datta, Smita Kumari. Is it clear? No? Is it clear? Fine. Good. Thank you. So now we have finished a lot of steps. Finally, now what we have? Now we have a solution with only DNA. Fine. So we started it with a bacterial cell. Now we have a DNA solution in our vial. Shall if we subject column to low speed centrifuge, then no damage will occur to DNA. Let me check. If we subject column to low speed centrifuge, then no damage will occur to DNA, RNA, and protein. Okay. No, it will be very low speed only. It is just why we are going for this low speed centrifuge method is when we go for gravitational separation based on Earth's gravitational force, this will take a long time. For example, if initially we are adding the aqueous solution, initially we are adding the cell extract on the top of the column. The cell extract, aqueous solution or cell extract to move from the top of the column up to the bottom will take a long time. If only it is under the gravitational force. So if we are going for a very low speed centrifuge, it will be very low speed only. Assume like, okay, centrifugation means something is rotating and you are keeping the column on that, then everything will be gone. No, it will be very low speed centrifuge. It will be some specialized centrifuge so that together with the gravitational force, since the column is having a small movement, a small shaking, the movement of the aqueous solution or the movement of the cell extract as well as all the salt solutions will take place in a comparatively higher speed when we compare it with the gravitational force only. Clear? Shalini. That's why we are going for low speed centrifugation. Is that clear? It won't go for any damage. Fine. So finally, now what we have in our hand, we are having a solution made up consisting of only DNA. We removed all the proteins, we removed all other cell debris, we remove all the RNA. Now we have only DNA. Fine. Now the next step is concentration of DNA samples. What do you mean by concentration? Anybody? Comment box. What do you mean by concentration? Concentrate. Sometimes when we learn, we will tell, okay, concentrate on your topic. Just concentrate. What do you mean by concentration? Anybody can type in the comment box. Concentration. Okay, leave it. Concentration is nothing but, now what we have in our hand, we have a solution which contains DNA. So if we check it, maybe 75% will be DNA and 25% will be the aqueous layer. Or 60% will be DNA, 40% will be the aqueous layer. So in concentration, what we are going to do? Whatever DNA we have in our hand or whatever DNA we have in the vial, we are going to separate it, elute it out. Purest form of DNA. In order to obtain the purest form of DNA, we are going for concentration. Is that clear? Why we are going for concentration of DNA sample? In order to obtain the highly concentrated or the purest form of DNA, we go for this step. Fine. Okay. Now, how we are going to do that? Organic extraction. So, we have seen two methods for purification of DNA. That is, first one is by using phenol chloroform mixture. Second one is by ion exchange chromatography. So if we are going for phenol chloroform mixture treatment, that is organic extraction, it results in a very thick solution of DNA, which does not need to be concentrated further. So if we are going for organic extraction, already we have a highly concentrated form of DNA with us. Whereas we are going for some other methods like ion exchange chromatography or some other method is possible, you will get more dilute solutions. Therefore, it is important to increase the DNA concentration, because before going for recombinant DNA technology experiments, we need to have a highly concentrated, purest DNA sample with us. That's what our purpose. Fine. Now, the most frequently used method for DNA concentration is ethanol precipitation. Fine. So, ethanol precipitation is the most common and the efficient method we are using for DNA concentration. So here what we are doing, in the presence of a salt, for example Na plus, and at the temperature of minus 20 degree Celsius, absolute ethanol efficiently precipitates polymeric nucleic acid. So we treat our dilute solution of DNA with absolute ethanol in the presence of salt such as Na plus sodium, and also at a temperature of around minus 20 degree Celsius. As a result, the absolute ethanol will precipitate the nucleic acid. Fine. There is, with a thick solution of DNA, the ethanol can be layered on the top of the sample, causing molecules to precipitate at the interface, which means I can explain it with the picture. See, here we have a solution with the, this is the this is the aqueous concentrated DNA solution. See, you have the ethanol here. So how DNA will remain? DNA will remain in between the ethanol and the aqueous. So you have seen some precipitation, protein precipitation. Do you remember? You have seen protein precipitation. There we explained proteins, precipitated proteins will remain as a white mass between the phenol and also between the water layer. Similarly here, when we are adding ethanol, our DNA will remain between the ethanol layer and between the solution, between the aqueous layer and the concentrated form. Fine. So again, we are going to the previous slide. So as a result, DNA will, so once we add ethanol, once we add absolute ethanol into the DNA dilute solution, DNA will be precipitated and remain between the aqueous layer and the ethanol layer. So now how we can remove DNA? We can remove DNA by using a glass rod through the ethanol into the DNA solution. When the rod is removed, DNA molecules will attach and can be pulled out of the solution in the form of a long fiber. Clear? We have seen in the picture. That also we have seen in the last picture. See here. Here you can see. Once we add ethanol into the DNA mixture, what is happening? The DNA will remain as a fibrous mass in this area. Clear? So here we have a glass rod. We are inserting a glass rod into the solution and we just move the glass rod slowly so that the DNA fibers will get attached with the glass rod like this. See? And once we take the glass rod out, the DNA fibers will also come out from the solution. That is one method. Method number one. So in the first method, what we do? We add absolute ethanol into the aqueous solution of DNA, the DNA and incubate it. The DNA will be precipitated and remain in between the ethanol layer and the aqueous layer like this, between the red and the white. Fine. So into that, we insert a glass rod and we move the glass rod in a circular motion slowly so that the DNA fibers will get attached with the glass rod like this. And once we take out the glass rod, the DNA will also come out from the solution. Clear? That is one method. Fine. So, yes, we are using a glass rod. Clear? That is one method. Now, when the rod is removed, DNA molecules will attach and can be pulled out of the solution. Now, another method is there. If we are adding absolute ethanol, that is 2.5 volume with a dilute DNA solution, that is 1 volume of the dilute DNA solution is taken, and into that we are adding 2.5 volumes of absolute ethanol. The precipitate can be collected by centrifugation and then redissolved in an appropriate volume of water. So two methods we can use. In one method, we can add absolute ethanol into aqueous solution of DNA in the presence of sodium ions at minus 20 degrees Celsius so that DNA will be precipitated and remain at the interface between the aqueous layer and the ethanol layer. Into that, we add a glass rod and tilt it slowly so that the DNA fibers will get attached with the glass rod and we will separate the DNA from the solution in the concentrated form as long fibers. Another method, we take 1 volume of aqueous solution of DNA. Into that, we are adding absolute ethanol 2.5 volume and subjected to centrifugation so that the DNA will remain as the at the bottom, and we have to redissolve this DNA with water. Fine. Now, ethanol precipitation has got the advantage of leaving short chain and monomeric nucleic acid components in the solution. So, apart from double stranded molecule, even small chains of single stranded DNA molecules will also remain in the solution when we are going for ethanol precipitation. Also, another advantage is ribonucleotides produced by ribonuclease treatment are therefore lost. So, if we are going for ethanol precipitation, we have got two advantages. The first advantage is all the short chain monomeric DNA will be remain in the solution or remain in the sample. Second advantage is if there is any RNA contamination or if we have any ribonucleotides, it will be also removed by ethanol precipitation. Clear? So that's it about ethanol precipitation, and that's all about the concentration of DNA molecules. How we are performing the concentration of DNA samples by ethanol precipitation, and you have all the pictures. This is the first method, method A, second method, method B. So there, what we are doing, we are going for centrifugation so that the precipitated DNA is collected by centrifugation at the bottom. Then you have to redissolve this DNA mixture in water, pure aqueous layer. Clear? Finally, this is the final topic for today, measurement of DNA concentration. So it's all started with the bacterial cell. Fine. We took the bacterial cell, we had grown the bacterial cell, then we first of all we went for cell lysis using lysozyme, then EDTA, then SDS, and we got all the cell contents out. Then all the cell excite or cell contents we treat with phenol or phenol chloroform mixture in order to, then also before that we, first of all the cell extract is removed and we treat it with either proteinase enzyme in order to convert polypeptides into monopeptides, also with ribonuclease enzyme in order to disintegrate the ribonucleotide subunits or RNA subunits. Then we treat it with phenol or phenol chloroform mixture in order to remove all the components and get the DNA in the purest form. Fine. Either we go for organic solvents or we go for ion exchange column chromatography in order to remove the DNA. Then in order to concentrate the DNA, again, we added ethanol, absolute ethanol, so that the DNA was precipitated either in the fibrous form or we went for centrifugation method where we got DNA. So lot of steps are there. See, it's all started with a bacterial cell, and now where we are. Now we have in our vial or we have in our append of tube, we have a concentrated DNA sample. Fine. Now, the final step in DNA isolation and purification is measurement of DNA concentration. We have to measure what. So we are telling, okay, we claim now we have a purified DNA sample with us. What is the level of our purity or what is our purity level? For that, we have to measure. We have to measure the DNA concentration. Now, why we are measuring? In order to know exactly how much DNA is present in a solution when carrying out gene cloning experiments. So before going for our experiments, before going for our recombinant DNA experiments, we have to know, we have to assume, or we have to not assume, we have to exactly measure how much DNA is present. So for that, DNA concentrations can be accurately measured by UV spectrophotometry, ultraviolet absorbance spectrophotometry. This is the method we are using for measurement of DNA concentration. What is the method? Ultraviolet absorbance spectrophotometry. By UV spectrophotometry, we can measure the purity or we can measure the concentration of our DNA. Clear? Now, what is the principle? The principle is nothing but the amount of UV radiation absorbed by a solution of DNA is directly proportional to the amount of DNA in the sample. Okay, that is the principle. What is the principle? The amount of UV radiation absorbed by a DNA solution is directly proportional to the amount of DNA present in the sample. That means if the amount of DNA in our sample is high, the amount of UV radiation absorbed will be, tell me, high or low? If the amount of DNA in our sample is high, what about the amount of absorbed UV, whether it is high or low? Type in the comment box. If the amount of DNA in our sample is high, what is the amount of UV radiation absorbed, whether it is high or low? Anybody, type in the comment box. Hi, Shalini, Maunia, hi. Yes, very good. Because it is directly proportional. Is that clear? Smita, Shanmadi, Shalini, Priyama Kumari, Maunia, Kanimudi, Darshana. Is that clear? What I have told you now? Yes, because amount of UV radiation absorbed by the solution of DNA is directly proportional to the amount of DNA. So if one side is high, second side is also high. If one side is low, second side is also low. Clear? Now, what is the amount? Now, usually, absorbance is measured at 260 nanometer, at which wavelength and absorbance of A260. A260 means absorbance at 260 nanometer will be, the value will be 1, which corresponds to 50 mg of double stranded DNA per ml. I will explain it very well. If you have a sample of 50 mg of pure double stranded DNA with you, the absorbance at 260 nanometer will be 1. Clear? If your sample, that is, if you have a solution of DNA with you, then you have 50 mg of double stranded DNA per ml of solution. If you measure the absorbance at 260 nanometer, that is nothing but A260, it will be, the value will be 1. So if it is more than 1, what will be? I told you, if you have a 50 mg of double stranded DNA per ml with you, the absorbance at 260 nanometer will be 1. Okay. Now, if your absorbance is more than 1, what will be your amount of DNA? If the absorbance is more than 1. What about the amount of DNA? Tell me. For 50 mg of DNA per ml, the absorbance at 260 nanometer is 1. If your absorbance is 1.5, what will be your amount of DNA? No, I don't want the exact value. I just want to know whether you have understood this statement. Tell me. If your absorbance is 1.5, yeah, very good. That's it, Kanimudi. Very good. More than 50 mg. That's it. Very simple. More than 50 mg. If you have 50 mg of UNA, if you have a 50 mg of DNA per ml at 260 nanometer, you will have the absorbance of 1. If your value is 1.1, it will be more than 50 mg. If your value is 1.5, more than 50 mg. But if your value is 20 mg, yes, then it is not highly concentrated, it is less concentrated. Clear? That's what, this is what the idea I want to give you. Fine. Now, by this method, we can measure even 1 microliter of DNA solution. That is, measurements of as little as 1 microliter of a DNA solution can be carried out in spectrophotometer. Even if we have only, but so we have to, we already we mentioned, if we have 50 mg of DNA per ml, that is 1 ml. Even we have 1 microliter also, we can measure the amount of DNA by using this technique. Clear? This is not only for ml, even for microliters, this technique is applicable. Now, ultraviolet absorbance is also used to check the purity of a DNA. So it is not only the amount of DNA, we can also check the purity, the pure, whether the DNA is pure or whether there is still there is any RNA or protein contamination, we can check by this method. Clear? That is, with a pure sample of DNA, the ratio of absorbance at 260 and 280 nanometer, which means A260/A280. So first of all, we will take the DNA solution. We will go for measurement of absorbance at 260 nanometer. Then we will measure the absorbance at 280 nanometer. And this ratio will be 1:8. That means if the ratio is less than 1:8, it indicates that the preparation is contaminated either with protein or with phenol. So that's what our inference. So more than measuring the concentration of a DNA, the ultraviolet absorbance spectrophotometry can also be used to check the purity of a DNA sample. For that, what we do, we take the DNA sample. First of all, we measure the absorbance at 260 nanometer. Then we measure the absorbance at 280 nanometer, and then we take the ratio. If the ratio is 1.8, which means the DNA is in the purest form, or more than 1.8 also. But in case the ratio is less than 1.8, it indicates that the preparation is contaminated either with protein or with phenol. Clear? Is this is it clear till this point, all of you? We started with isolation of DNA. We went for cell lysis. Then we remove the proteins and RNA. Then we went for concentration of DNA. Then we measured the concentration of DNA. Then we measured the purity of DNA. Is this clear till this point? Everyone, I need the answer from everyone. Do anyone have any doubt? I have seen few answers, Shalini, Kanimudi, Darshana, Shanmati and all. Is it clear for everyone? Darshana, Kanimudi, Maunia, Prema Kumari, Shalini, Shanmati, Smita Kumari, everyone, is that clear? Till here? No. So that means you don't have any doubt, Shalini. Fine. If you don't have any doubt, before winding up the session, we will go for few exercises. I will just read out the question and also the options, and you can give me the answer in the comment box. Clear? Yeah, good. Thank you, Smita. Yes, first question, MCQ, multiple choice. EDTA is dash. Option A, ethylene dioxide tetraacetate. Option B, ethylene diamine tetraacetate. Option C, ethylene diamine tetraacetate. Option D, ethylene dioxide tetraacetate. Yes, yes, yes. I am having the answers. Okay, everyone knows that. B, 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 B. Okay, good, good, good. That means EDTA is nothing but ethylene diamine tetraacetate. So why we are using EDTA? We are using it for cell lysis. Fine. Now, what is the purpose of EDTA? What EDTA is going to do? It will remove the magnesium ions, and also it will retard the cellular enzymes which will cause apoptosis. So when we get a question, we are getting all the associated points related to that question. Clear? So the next question answer, nobody please don't type. I will ask a person for the next question. From the next question onwards, I will ask a person. That person has to give me the answer. Don't type the answer in the comment box, all of you, please. Thank you. So the second question, the purpose of SDS in DNA extraction is dash. First option, digest the polymeric compounds of cell wall. Second option, removal of lipid molecules. Third option, removal of insoluble cell debris. Fourth option, inhibition of cellular enzymes. And I need the answer from Darshana. Can you type the answer, Darshana? The purpose of SDS. Yes, Darshana. Is that your answer? B? Any other answers from anybody? Now all of you can type the answer. Everyone is going for B. Okay, very good. Removal of lipid molecules. Yes, that's what SDS. SDS is nothing but, already we have learned, SDS is nothing but it is a detergent which will remove the lipid molecules. As a result, it will speed up or accelerate the cell wall disintegration. Clear? Good, 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 good. Yes, here comes the third question. Yeah. Don't type the answer. Ion exchange chromatography separates DNA, RNA and proteins based on A, electrical affinity, B, electrical charge, C, all the above, D, none of the above. Ion exchange that we studied today. I want the answer from Maunia. Can you type the answer, Maunia? C, all the above. Yeah, all of you can type the answer now. Everyone, any different answers, welcome. one type C, everyone is typing C. Why everyone is typing C? Yeah, already we have explained this thing, right? Ion exchange chromatography, it works on mainly electrical charge also, because since DNA, RNA and proteins are negative charge, we are using positively charged microbeads made up of organic polymers. Fine. And then the electrical affinity, the amount of binding or the extent of binding, all those things will play a role. Good. Now another question, don't type the answer. SDSEs. Option A, sodium dodecyl sulfate. Option B, sodium dodecyl sulfate. Option C, sodium dodinyl sulfate. Option D, sodium didyl sulfate. And I want the answer from Prema Kumari. You can type the answer. Prema Kumari, you can type the answer. SDS, what is SDS? Sodium dodecyl sulfate, sodium dodecyl sulfate, sodium dodinyl sulfate, sodium didyl sulfate. Yes, Prema Kumari, are you there? Prema Kumari, are you there? I can see you online. Prema Kumari, I am not sure whether you are hearing me. Okay, the question passes to Kanimuri. Can you type the answer, Kanimuri? Yeah, B. Darshana, B. Sodium dodecyl sulfate. Is there any answer from anybody? Yeah, all these are direct questions actually, right? B. It is nothing but SDS is sodium dodecyl sulfate. Yes. And finally, another question. Yeah, don't type the answer. An absorbance of 1 at 260 nanometer, that is A260, corresponds to 15 mg of single stranded DNA per ml. A. False. B. True. C. Irrelevant data. D. Insufficient data. Any answers? Yeah, all of you can type the answer. Type the answer, all of you. All of you type the answer for this question. An absorbance false. Mavania, you type false. A. That is option A. Yeah, Shanmadi, A. Why you are typing A? Why? What is the problem there? An absorbance of 1 at 260. Why you have typed? Can anybody give me the correct statement in the comment box? An absorbance of 1 at 260 nanometer corresponds to 15 mg of single stranded DNA per ml. Why you type A? Darshana, Shanmadi. It gives 50 mg of double stranded DNA. It is for double stranded DNA. That is the first thing. Second thing is it gives. Yeah, that's okay, Priyama. You are suffering from cold and fever. No problem. Don't worry. Okay, so yeah, that's true. The first thing is an absorbance of 1 at 260 nanometer, that is A260, corresponds to 50 mg, not 15 mg. That is one thing. Second thing is not single stranded, it is double stranded DNA. That is 50 mg of double stranded DNA. If it is present in our solution, the absorbance will be 1 at 260 nanometer. Very good. That means it is clear. The topic is clear. Yeah, so yes, with this our today's presentation comes to an end, and over to the organizers now.
Okay, thank you, sir. So students, if you have any query regarding today's topic, please comment.
So in the next class, we will be continuing from here. Okay, now we have DNA isolated with us in the purest form actually. So now we'll be moving on to the next topic in the next class. Clear? So now only we have covered the isolation of bacterial DNA. Now we have to go for a few other samples as well. And then we will pass on to the next step. So step by step, we will move with the rDNA technology. Clear? Yes. Yeah, anybody have any doubts, please type in the comment box. Otherwise, once you learn this topic or once you go through this topic, if you strike with any doubts, please feel free to contact me on my WhatsApp number or mail ID. Clear?
So if you have any, if you understood the today's session, please comment yes in the comment box. Okay, that's fine. So students, let me tell you that 10 November is our deadline, okay, for registration for CSIR program. So those who are not registered, just Kanimoji and Smita, it's a request to you, please make your registration soon, because we are stopped taking our demo classes. Now we are go through our structural classes. So Shivam is already mentioned everything. So in our group, I'm already shared our brochure. So it's a request to you all that please share the browser to your friends too, that they all are get a benefited. And thank you so much, sir. And it was really very informative. And thank you. Now I'm stop our meeting.